This is the story of how Britain became a nation of television addicts and of the shows and the stars that captivated us all.
Bloody blasphemous garbage!
I couldn't go anywhere without being mobbed.
People were recognising you everywhere. You couldn't believe it.
When did I first realise I was a star? I thought when I got my first death threat.
This is how TV's first showbiz set revelled in their unparalleled fame and fortune.
Temptation can be there, and you're there to be tempted.
It was obvious that there was some kind of chemistry going on between us.
Now, orgy was possible, you see, then.
We were sleeping with everybody all the time, several times a day.
Yet while some would become TV legends, others would rise and fall almost overnight.
He was on our TV screens every Saturday, and then suddenly he wasn't.
Well, he was crap, wasn't he? Bollocks.
There are some people who regret that television was ever invented.
Less than 50 years ago, Britain had virtually no television. The BBC broadcast for several hours a day, but few people were tempted to buy a set of their own. TV was a long way from catching on. When it came to entertainment, the radio, cinema and music hall were top of the bill. Hardly anyone looked to television.
I remember the people next door having a television and going over and seeing Muffin the Mule and things like that, and that was quite nice, I mean. But we weren't interested, it was, we were so much radio.
Television was so unimportant. Nobody wanted to go on television. Nobody. Nobody was watching it, not even the cameraman. I mean, it was just a waste of your material to go on there. People were scared. Oh, if I go on there, everyone will know my act. Well, nobody would know your act because nobody's watching.
This is BBC Television.
Overseer, undertaker, pest destroyer, boilermaker, chimney sweep and steeplejack.
While the BBC had been broadcasting since the 1930s, its most popular programme attracted just 300,000 viewers.
London, all right, have you got a piece of mime ready for the experts?
What's My Line was a very staid affair, although the controversial radio presenter Gilbert Harding was a star turn.
I know exactly what you are. You go round working instruments to find out who have not taken out television licences.
If you went into Madame Tussauds in 1955, you would see a statue of Gilbert Harding, the BBC's number one star. And underneath, it didn't say Gilbert Harding. The plaque said, the most famous man in Britain. And that's all it said. That's all it needed to say. Everybody knew Gilbert Harding.
In 1955, the government announced that the BBC would face a rival, a commercial television service. But the news was ridiculed inside the BBC.
The BBC thought that it wasn't going to happen. And if it did happen, it's going to be a disaster, because how can you possibly get commercial television to be anything like the BBC with these years of experience behind it? And of course, they were very wrong. Very wrong.
45 seconds.
Commercial television was about to hit air with a revolutionary lineup of entertainment, offering the public glamour and excitement without ever leaving their living room. The British home was about to be changed forever.
Radio division mixers, sound mixers, cameramen, directors.
1-0.
Fix sound.
Good evening, everybody. How do you do?
Suddenly, this upstart network came in and were putting on programs that people had never had, with stars and personalities that people in all parts of the country never would have had a chance of seeing.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Diana Dawes Show.
We suddenly had real television stars, light entertainment stars, game show hosts. It was a very big thing.
They wanted populist entertainment that everybody was... That's what I want to go to the theatre to see. That's what I want to pay for. That's what they wanted. That's what they got. And ITV gave it to them in spades.
27-year-old comedian Bob Monkhouse was chosen as the face of a new generation when ITV launched in the Midlands.
That was really a great moment for me to walk out on stage for the first time to that audience with taking its breath in and say my opening line, which was, "Hello, traitors." Boom. Because everyone felt guilty. They were deserting the BBC to embrace this new monster. They felt like traitors. So the line was spot on for their emotional reaction.
Thank heaven for little girl.
But behind the scenes of the first ATV show, Monkhouse glimpsed what the television revolution would deliver. Fame, excitement and sex.
The biggest star we had on the opening night for ITV in the Midlands was a Hollywood star, incredibly handsome man called Tyrone Power. And they said, write a comedy sketch for him. I said, are you sure he'll do it? Yeah, that's what he's come for.
They'd written dialogue, sort of humorous, quote-unquote, humorous dialogue to go between Monkhouse and Tyrone Power.
First thing in the morning, the call came, come over and go over the lines with Mr. Power. So I get the sketch and I go over and I knock on the door and I go in. And in the bath was Tyrone Power. Nude.
In Bob goes, and Tyrone Power stood up in the bath and pointed to his member and said, get a hold of that.
He said, you look nervous. Take your clothes off and get in the bath. Let's see if I can cure your headache. You can certainly fix mine. But I guess when you're that big a star, whatever gratification you want, you just get it whenever you want it. And I was on hand. Well, I wasn't on hand, as it happened. I wasn't on anything.
I suppose if I'd been sent, I might have been more helpful, I suppose.
Unaware of the scandals backstage, the first ITV viewers were blown away by the big-name American stars and shows being beamed direct to their living room. Groundbreaking quiz shows adapted from the States, like Take Your Pick, shocked the nation with the amount of money they were giving away.
Sixpence.
No, thank you.
£7.
No, thank you.
£8.
No, thank you.
£9.
No, thank you, sir.
£9, open box number three.
At a time when most people were lucky to get a week in Blackpool, ITV was giving away big cash and prizes that could change your life.
Tom, you have won tonight's star prize.
And tonight's star prize is a Mediterranean cruise for two.
While ITV viewers were offered glamorous foreign holidays, the BBC quiz shows were stuck in an almost Victorian time warp.
And you only got to keep your eye on me and you're in.
Lobsters can swim backwards. Is that right or is it wrong?
Yes.
Right, well, give him half a crown, Barney.
ITV were giving out substantial amounts of money. BBC was still running Wilfred Pickles and Mabel.
Captain Webb, what was he famous for?
Swimming the Channel.
Swimming the Channel. Give him half a crown, Barney.
And he would say at the end of this, right, how much is in the kitty now then, Mabel? And she'd say, £3, 4 and 6. She'd say, £3, 4 and 6, eh? Oh, of course, all the old biddies in the audience go, £3, 4 and 6. Right, now for £3, 4... I mean, there was no competition, question. Really.
And how old are you?
I've just turned 90.
Are you?
Yes.
Well, you won't...
ITV's barrage of glamorous entertainment had seen a rush of interest in television. But the BBC couldn't comprehend the effect of competition.
There was a feeling that it was the duty of a broadcasting organisation to inform, to educate and to entertain, and entertainment came last on that list.
They'd been so complacent, not to say arrogant, because they were television and they were not television per se anymore. They got a rival.
We crave your indulgence. We beg your applause. We are your servants.
The BBC's first noticeable reaction was a star-studded production and very public plea for everyone to support good old Auntie and pay their £3 licence fee.
£3 isn't much to pay for something different every day.
Their television future was in danger of disappearing into oblivion. Shocked by the output of their commercial rivals, many at the BBC questioned whether they should stay in the TV business at all.
There was a slight feeling of panic. Television proved to be quite expensive. And the way commercial television were doing it, I mean, all their fees were three times as BBC fees. There was a genuine feeling that maybe the BBC wouldn't be able to afford to go on.
The age of television competition had begun, and the BBC were now struggling to stay on air. But it would be ITV who had hit crisis point first, as the first ratings war unfolded.
The ugly crop of television aerials, like demented hat stands, they are spreading like this throughout the country.
Within weeks of ITV's launch, watching television became a phenomenon. And the show that everyone was glued to became a Sunday night institution.
Da 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 da. Anybody who'd lived at that time could sing you the theme song. It just went into your consciousness. The moment ITV started, that became the representative show. BBC had never had anything like it.
There wasn't a ratings war, really, in those days. But I think when Sunday Night the Palladium came on the scene, people were aware then that you had two channels.
Variety stars like Max Bygraves would have been seen once a year in the local theatre, but now were available live and direct every Sunday night in your living room.
We're having a ball tonight. You're all invited to the ball tonight. One and all.
This seems to be a very special show.
Is it real?
They're not a normal type of audience.
No, no. Well, it's full to start with, isn't it, you know?
Yes.
There'd be nothing like Sunday Night at the Palladium on television. People felt they were there, and it became this big... That became a big event. People didn't want to miss that.
Variety had arrived. It really was, in a big way. When I say variety, I mean you'd get the big, big stars from America coming over to start live at the London Palladium. Oh, I remember seeing Tommy Trinder. He was the all-round entertainer, the consummate of the all-round entertainer.
The Palladium's first host was a much-loved musical performer who became television's first superstar.
Good evening, everybody. How do you do?
Look what I've picked up.
Cyril, have you had bookmakers on this stage? It's not warm. It must have been dropped last night. Liberace's.
Trinder revelled in his new status as compere of TV's biggest show, but also set the precedent for a TV star being talented yet uncontrollable.
Trinder was delighted when Bob Hope came over to do the Palladium. But at the rehearsals, Tommy was disgusted to see against the front row seats were big cue cards with all Bob Hope's jokes on. And he didn't think that was on. He thought, you know, he could have memorised the act and everything. And, of course, Palladium was live in those days. So he went on and he said, now it's time to talk to Bill, one of the world's great comedians.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Well, here we are back again.
He said, God, this man is so funny. Here's some of the things he's going to say. And he started reading the cards. And apparently Bob Hope was in the wings going, where's he got to? Where's he got? You know, mentally having to cross off each card that Tom... He did about three cards worth of jokes, then introduced Bob Hope with a little nod, like, get on with it.
Despite humiliating the world's biggest star, what made Trinder priceless to ITV in its first year was his ability to appeal to the new television-buying public.
Mr and Mrs Hindson from Darlington, I see that Mr Hindson is a schoolmaster. Aye, aye. What do you teach?
Children.
Children. Now, beat the clock, you've got 50 seconds, it's up to you. Start patting the balloon now. Well, start the game.
The Palladium's Beat the Clock game show was a revolutionary format that introduced audience participation for the first time. Trinder was a brilliant man of the people.
Over here. Yes, he's down the game, number.
But despite appearances, Tommy Trinder was not the most powerful man in television. The man behind the Palladium show and the launch of ITV was the Mr. Big of British show business. By the mid-50s, Lou Grade, with his brother Leslie, owned and controlled virtually every theatre and performer in the country.
It's the quality and the idea of the project that count, not what is it going to cost. That you face afterwards.
Lou made ITV because they had the Palladium and they could put everybody on that stage at the Palladium and judge whether they would work on TV or not. And if they would work, they'd stick him into that week's variety show on that Saturday night.
During the first 6 months of ITV, the charismatic impresario had ploughed hundreds of thousands of pounds into making the Palladium television's greatest show. Yet while TV sales were booming, neither Grade nor any of ITV's backers were getting any return on their investment.
They probably underestimated the costs of a television because a lot of capital was required. They had to be pioneers in a kind of a way. And some of them didn't really want to be pioneers. They just wanted to make money.
News talk.
Or butter. What about you?
Their only income would come from the new TV commercials. Yet no one had found a way of proving how many people were watching ITV or its ads. By the middle of 1956, commercial TV's moguls were getting desperate and resorting to any pseudo-scientific methods to prove they were a success.
News talk. Can you tell it from butter?
We bought in, I think it was an IBM computer, to find out what the viewer really thought. Now, these computers were enormous. They took up a whole enormous room and were run by a wonderful Hungarian. But all his conclusions had to be hidden. First of all, he discovered that one of the dramas, Tightrope, was very popular with sadists. That was one of his conclusions. Bonanza was very popular with homosexuals because it was three brothers and a father and the woman always died or left or was a bitch. And then worst of all, was that he discovered that BBC viewers ate more margarine than those who were watching commercial television. Well, as we lived by margarine commercial. He was sort of sidestepped.
News talk.
Butter.
Butter.
News talk.
While ITV sought an early indicator of success, 6 months after their launch, the papers were full of the antics of the BBC's Mr. Controversial, Gilbert Harding. The What's My Line panellist now had his own show and was making a living out of being rude.
I wanted to talk for a little bit about the infuriating idiocies of the laws under which we groan, labour and suffer. Now, the Home Secretary has a lot to put up with.
A world away from ITV's variety shows, Harding's fame even extended to him playing himself in feature films.
I suppose it never occurred to you that I might be using that newspaper.
Gilbert, you're the very man I want.
Harding was becoming notorious for speaking his mind, but it seemed TV had unearthed another loose cannon. At the BBC, staff were dealing with both his increasingly rash behaviour and alcohol consumption.
No, you better bring the whole bottle.
Yes, sir.
He used to drink. I wasn't the only producer who had to get him out of the pub next door to the television theatre in Shepherd's Bush 10 minutes before airtime.
For the papers, he was good copy because he was either losing his temper and insulting somebody on the radio or television, or turning up drunk. And he was often banned from the BBC for 2 or 3 months at a time.
I'm tired of saying and tired of recognising the fact that I can't drive owing to a deficiency in manners, temper, concentration and reaction.
The fledgling ITV had far bigger problems than an errant star. It was simply running out of money, and Lou Grade was privately asking his wife to support his investment.
She always felt that whatever he set out to do, he would achieve. And there was a time when he said to her, we're really not going to get any further. There's no more money coming in.
There was definitely a period where they thought it might fail. And I know that Lou told his wife, Kathy, that she may have to sell some of her jewellery.
Money, yes. Well, I mean, at the beginning, there was no money except that everybody was getting mammoth expenses because they were making up their own chitties because there was no accounts department. Then we were told to be very careful because, of course, they were losing money. They were losing money like mad. There was rediffusion money, Associated Newspapers money, and various other money. And then, suddenly, they realised that in 1 year, we were going to make a lot of money.
Finally, in September 1956, a full year after the launch of ITV, the first proper TV ratings were announced. They revealed that the new generation of TV viewers were almost all addicted to ITV. The BBC had not got a single programme in the charts. Across the country, the number of sets had risen from 200,000 to 5 million. The shares of companies like ATV rocketed. Lou Grade, from being nearly bankrupt, was destined to be a multi-millionaire. ITV would become a license to print money, and Grade the king of the new entertainment world.
He was the godfather. If you passed the Grade test, you could be made, and if you incurred displeasure or stepped out of line, you could be ruined and just shamble over to the BBC and see if they wanted you. You know what I mean?
The word is going around that there are two very important people out there.
Really?
Not Lou and Leslie.
The Grades would now hold a virtual monopoly and could make or break a star. Anyone who rocked the boat was risking their livelihood.
I feel that these days we're getting too many medical shows, you know, emergency ward team. Yeah, can you imagine if the British Medical Association started running television? They'd have shows like The Burns and Abrasion Show. I Love Leukemia.
Tommy Trinder, the cheeky chap who'd launched ITV, was to become television's first casualty. Lou Grade, its first assassin.
On the Friday, before I got a show on Sunday, Lou said, "Oh, by the way, Bill, you haven't got Tommy Trinder on Sunday." "Oh, why?"
There was some gag or some joke he had done at some stage that seemed to seriously offend the Grades. Whether it was a sort of slightly racist Jewish joke or something, they took umbrage.
They asked him to stop it. Otherwise, he's off the show. He said, "Oh, don't tell me what to do, you lucky people." That was his catchphrase. And they said, "All right, you're off the show." And he never worked for ITV again.
At 49 years of age, Trinder's ITV career was over.
He was chopped and sort of really cut off, really. And they, you know, like they could do in those days.
A falling out, be it financial or artistic or anything with them, was equivalent to, I don't know, horse's head in the bed. you'd be away and gone, and the great Trinder sort of talked his way out of the job.
Lou Grade had provided television with its first celebrity casualty and was now moving on to new members of the showbiz set.
The last time I met Tommy Trinder was in Newcastle, trying to use television, and he was doing a warm-up. You could tell they'd no idea who he was, this great former star. I realised that a lot of the younger members of the audience were very intrigued by this quite old man with a hat. And I had a drink with him afterwards, and he said, "I know what you're thinking." He said, I just want to be part of it, that's all. I want to keep going, even if it's a warm-up." So he couldn't go away from it. He couldn't walk away from it.
Commercial television, the sponsor said that he would be a great big star overnight. So he made his big decision and went into television. The sponsors were right, he was a star overnight.
People are talking, and today people are talking about fan fever.
By the late 50s, thanks to ITV, television presenters were becoming the nation's first pop idols.
If you hadn't got a false eye and a hump on your back, they would mob you. And I remember being in a car with about 500 teenage girls, banging the car and rocking the car. But I must say, when that car went, turned right over on its side on two wheels, I didn't think we're going to die here. We're going to die.
a new generation of entertainers was emerging with their sights set on the small screen, and Soho was the place to get noticed. The late night club circuit was the fast track to the showbiz set.
I think a lot of the television performers more or less had the same background that I did. You didn't say, I'm going to be a TV performer. You all started out, you know, kind of plying your trade.
Churchill's nightclub was one of the favourite breeding grounds for new talent.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning. Churchill's Club presents...
TV hopefuls performed into the early hours in front of a dubious mix of showbiz scouts, TV producers and gangsters.
You come out on stage, what's on in London, what's doing tonight, what's new in this great big city when the lights are bright, and it would be the gangsters from north of the Thames would be in one day, or the next day it would be film producers from Hollywood.
You'd go on at 1 o'clock in the morning and you'd have the dregs of London, you know, all the wide boys, you know, looking for somewhere to go before they did a burglary. And
the hostesses, I'm sure half of them were hookers. And you'd see on stage so many of the people like Danny LaRue or Ronnie Corbett in the cabaret there. And then you'd eventually see them appear on television. But this was their grounding in these clubs. They were quite remarkable times.
There was an absolute jungle of late entertainment in the West End, all putting on a show of varied wit and some none at all.
For all the TV wannabes, the purpose of being there was to be seen performing by ITV's supremo Lou Grade or his network of scouts.
There was a great story of Lou Grade seeing a young comedian he liked very much and going round to see this comedian in his dressing room afterwards and saying, you're very good, who's your agent? And the comedian said, you are, Mr. Grade. So, you know, he had such a vast stable of people, he hadn't noticed he'd got this comic on.
The man Grade did choose from this generation was about to have his life turned upside down. Plucked from the clubs, the unknown comedian was given the biggest job in television, on Sunday night at the London Palladium, replacing the great Tommy Trinder.
My mother, who had so much ambition for me, would say, we'd love to see you on that show, Bruce. I wonder if one day you'll ever get on Sunday Night at the Palladium. I said, oh, well, you know, I don't know.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Sunday Night at the London Palladium.
I always remember he said, I've got a packet all in, a rather tobacconist. And then the following year, I bumped into him, and he'd just been to a press conference for his very first Palladium, which he was going to do that Sunday. And I congratulated him. I said, what's happened to the tobacconist? It postponed.
I don't think a television show has ever been more important to any artist in this country than Sunday Night at the London Palladium was to Bruce Forsyth. Suddenly, from being a lowly comic appearing in the halls around Britain, he was an overnight star. He was enormous.
Is there somebody you'd like to say hello to? Who would you like to
Forsyth say? Took over as host, giving the top-rated show on TV a fresh appeal as he insulted and flirted with the audience.
We definitely hit on something here. Read all about it next time.
Within weeks, his celebrity status soared when he introduced the first television catchphrase to sweep the nation.
He was doing fine, and then eventually somebody barracked him from the back, and he looked up and he said, you know, I'm in charge. And that became, overnight, a kind of a catchphrase.
I'm in charge? You've been to my tailor. Get it off!
I couldn't go anywhere without people shouting out, I'm in charge. There'd be trucks going around with, I'm in charge, on the back of the truck.
People were having I'm in charge sort of on their hats and sticking things on their bumpers.
The power of television was enormous then.
Marvellous what you can do on TV, isn't it? Suppose I could be watching myself, really.
In an era before pop stars, Bruce Forsyth went from relative obscurity to leader of the show business pack.
The city right over there.
Television fame made him overnight the showbiz set's most unlikely sex symbol. Almost inevitably, his marriage came under pressure as female fans threw themselves at him.
And then I signaled him to come and join me.
It changed him. Women are attracted to the star aura, however ugly or unpersonable a star may be, stars have star attraction, and Bruce Forsyth was no exception.
Temptation can be there, and you're there to be tempted. And it can be very difficult at times not to take that. You're always attractive to people just because of what you do, and the fact that you're famous. It's not that you're the best-looking hunk in the world. That doesn't come into it. You're famous, and people like to talk to famous people.
However, there was no tabloid Rat Pack at large in the late 50s. It would be some time before the story of Forsyth's failing marriage to dancer Penny Calvert would emerge.
His wife, Penny Calvert, came to me, was by then his ex-wife, and asked me to write the story of her life with him. And what I learned from Penny, not firsthand, but what I learned from Penny, I was very uncomfortable with. She was deeply distressed because he had become a ladies' man.
Is that the right temper?
It's the longest headline that has ever been run in a British newspaper. It ran from one side of the centre pages to the other, down four lines, and it was, Penny Calvert says, I should have believed Bruce when he sang to me on stage at the London Palladium.
How could you believe me when I said I love you when you've never been a liar?
You sure have been a liar!
A double-crossing liar.
A double-crossing liar, all your
doggone cheating lies.
British television's early years were remarkably scandal-free. Although behind the film premieres and publicity shots, the stars were indulging in sex, drugs and rock and roll that would have blown the sensibilities of 50s Britain apart.
When we went out, we had to look prim and noble, perhaps, and beautifully dressed and everything, because underneath, people were leading just as untidy, rumbustious lives as they are now.
Fucking did not start in 1963, despite what Philip Larkin may have said.
The great parties that we went to, some of them developed into orgies. The affairs that we had were more or less secret within show business. There were tabloids, yes, the Daily Sketch and the Daily Mirror, but they didn't intrude, they didn't look into your private life the way the tabloids do today. It would be impossible to live that kind of carefree, casual sex life that we had then.
Bob Monkhouse was also in the showbiz set's Premier League. He had his own show and was at the epicentre of the showbiz set's decadent playtimes.
One or two people have written saying that I haven't a romantic personality, and this hurt me. It really did. In fact, one of my biggest problems is, am I too sexy to get loves?
Despite being married, Monkhouse began an affair during the 50s with TV sex symbol Diana Dawes. On screen, she was the glamorous host of her own show. Off screen, she hosted some of the showbiz set's most legendary gatherings.
Some of the parties were extraordinary that were given at that time. Diana Dawes had a room fitted with a mirror in the ceiling, and which was pretty sexy, so that if people did want to indulge themselves in the room below, they could see themselves reflected in the mirror, which was pretty novel at that time. The especially novel aspect of that mirror was that it was a two-way mirror, and they were gathered around it like like jungle animals drinking from a pool. I had been invited to take part with a very attractive young lady. I said to Diana, I think I know what's happening in there. I think I'd have an audience. And she said, oh, you're too shy.
There were two groups of people that we knew who did have orgies, and several others who loved partous, who had threesomes.
Diana Dawes' parties became legendary, and tabloid journalists were welcomed with open arms, knowing they'd never kiss and tell.
I remember that I went to one party that she and she was standing at the door, and as I went in, she slipped me a little bottle full of purple hearts, which everybody took in those days to keep you awake for, well, not just for a night, two or three nights. And she said, those are for you, darling, have a good party.
I'm sure there's a lot of reporters did end up at Diana Dawes's, but they just didn't talk about it. They thought we were having too much of a good time. We don't want this to get out.
At the party, we had Robert Mitchum and George Hamilton and the whole crowd. Oh, Peter Sellers came and Trevor Hart, a mass of people, including Lionel Blair.
I was wrecked at the end of it. I didn't know what I was saying, and I started to cry, and she said, do you know why you're like this? And I said, no. All the food and all the drink was laced with drugs.
I think we called it purple creeping Jesus. It was made with that wonderful grape juice that was purple, you know, and the thing, it was dynamite. What I didn't know is a chum of mine had put methadone in it. He had spiked it. Well, of course, after half an hour, everyone was flying around the room. There's a George Hamilton, spent about three quarters of an hour driving around Belgrave Square, couldn't find his way out of it. Eventually, the police had to take him back to the Mayfair Hotel. They had to lead him back. Extraordinary.
However, there was one television celebrity never seen at any showbiz set parties.
There. Not bad, was it?
Not bad. It was dreadful.
The star of BBC TV, Gilbert Harding, was exploiting his gruff manner in adverts and feature films, but found his celebrity fame totally unsatisfying.
Do you know what happens to you when you allow yourself to be regularly exhibited in that glass rectangle?
No,
well, I'll
really.
Tell you. You become public property. Your face, electronically distorted, is huddled round and gawped at by three-quarters of the population of the United Kingdom. And within a month, every wrinkle, every wart and pustule has become part of our British way of life.
He was essentially a very private man. I mean, an erudite, bookish, learned man, found himself in this extraordinary position of being a TV star, and we were only just finding out what a TV star was. And suddenly people would come up to him as if they owned him and say, oh, Gilbert, why didn't you get that on? I knew what job he was doing. And Gilbert found it very difficult to cope with.
You are known as the rudest man in Britain.
Well, that's not fair. There's something phony about me, I suppose, because I have no particular talent, you see.
Signing autographs and things was not part of his lifestyle. He didn't really understand all that. He wasn't remotely show business. And of course, he was gay as well, which really tortured him, because in those days, he could have been in prison. And it was he was a very tortured soul, Gilbert.
In the 1950s, there was no comprehension that the most famous man in Britain might be gay. Homosexuality was totally illegal. Harding had to lead a secretive private life with friends covering his tracks.
I don't recall his ever being out by himself. Behind that was the fear that if he's left to himself and he has too much to drink, he might do or say something rash which would lead to his being blackmailed and horrible front page news. I remember that the chauffeurs were often very young men and they seemed to disappear after two or three weeks. So I suppose there was a few hands placed on knees, which is why the chauffeurs resigned.
If that had come out, as they say, then it would have been curtains. If there'd been one of those notorious incidents in a public lavatory, then that would have been that.
Tabloid interest in the TV stars' lives was growing, but Gilbert Harding would not be the first victim of the press. One Sunday in January 1960, the nation woke up to television's first scandalous expose on Diana Dawes.
That was the first time I can ever recall the papers really going for someone. You suddenly see a headline, you think, oh, God, it was all going on then.
Details of wild sex parties scandalised the nation, and the TV career of Britain's biggest sex symbol was about to be put in jeopardy. But the days of the free and easy showbiz set still hold halcyon memories for some.
I did go to an orgy once that was particularly jolly. The awkward part about an orgy is afterwards you're not too sure who to thank. But I do remember the following morning finding a blister in a place where a man doesn't want to find a blister, and going to the doctor and saying, is there someone out there with an unspeakable infection? And he said, no, there's someone out there with only one contact lens.
If you wanna have fun, come home with me. You can stay all night and play with my TV. TV is the thing this year. This
Your selling will actually go beyond the shop. This adds variety to the work and often a cup of tea.
Now it's out of date. TV is the thing this year.
By 1960, the way Britain entertained itself had changed forever. 5 short years after ITV's launch, Britain was a nation of television addicts.
I got to Britain in the early 60s, having just left Australia, where there was almost no television, it had only just started, and I walked straight into a television culture. Britain was crazy about television.
The decade was about to kick off with two shows which truly symbolised the arrival of the television age.
TV is the thing this year.
This is the London Palladium.
After years of lobbying, ITV persuaded the Palace to allow the 1960 Royal Variety Show to be televised for the first time. It was another coup for commercial television. The British public in the masses would now switch on to ITV to see a watershed in television's short history.
Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Monday night at the Royal Emporium.
Bruce Forsyth compared a showcase of talent that had never been seen together on television before.
Compare spot on such a bill.
Set, go, man, go. I got a girl that I love.
Cliff Richard. Benny Hill, Norman Wisdom, Frankie Howard and Hattie Jakes drew in a record television audience of over 20 million people. But behind the scenes of this show, there was controversy over Diana Dawes. Dawes had become too big a star to be left off the bill, but the shocking News of the World scandal had turned the British establishment against her, with even the Archbishop of Canterbury calling her a wayward hussy.
Dawes was thrilled out of her boots when the Archbishop of Canterbury called her a wayward hussy. She said she thought she was a dreary tart. Now she was a wayward hussy. Thrilled.
But the show's organisers were not thrilled. Although it was too late to remove her from the bill, Dawes was banned from meeting the Queen in the after-show lineup. It was a message to the free and easy showbiz set that they would now have to watch their behaviour. TV was now big business. The Royal Variety Show would become the cornerstone of TV entertainment for the next 20 years, and the performers became preoccupied by their royal patrons.
Bud Flanagan.
What was the matter?
Asked me if I wanted to buy a new spring overcoat.
Oh, he would. Oh, shameful.
I used to hate doing the Royal Variety Shows. You're playing to Wimbledon. The heads are swivelling left and right. Is he funny? Is the Royal Box laughing?
There's a car outside causing an obstruction. It's got to be moved. It's holding up all the traffic.
What's the number of the car, then? What's the number of the car?
The number of the car is HRH.
One or two favourite performers were obviously perfect for it. The Crazy Gang, Flanagan and Allen. Marvellous.
That car's always causing trouble.
They were cheeky enough, they were just naughty enough to actually look at the box or refer to the royals being there, which was verboten, verboten.
I'll leave it a minute. Will you sling the keys down, man?
The broadcasting of the Royal Variety Show marked ITV's coming of age. Almost half the population was now sitting down to watch television at the same time, and it was invariably ITV that stayed on all night.
My auntie never saw any work I did for the BBC. And my mother said, did you see Steptoe last night? She said, no. She said, well, you know, why not? She said, well, it's on BBC. BBC, we don't watch BBC. You know, we only watch ITV. The set was rigid. It was solid.
Rusted onto ITV.
Because she felt that the BBC was for posh people. And people like her were ITV fans.
They were just taking the audience off the BBC in a frightening fashion. I suppose it was the first time that anybody started asking the question, even if privately, you know, can we justify the licence fee if maybe as little as a third of the audience are watching us at any given time?
ITV dominated the TV ratings, but all the headlines in 1960 came from a groundbreaking BBC interview programme called Face to Face. The corporation's own star name, Gilbert Harding, was about to be grilled by a fearless, if faceless, assassin.
You tell me, slightly disappointingly perhaps, that on the whole you're not satisfied, that you're not really fulfilled in
your life. No, not at all satisfied.
All right. What's lacking?
Oh, I think that the thing that is really lacking is a sense of purpose, you know. There's not much point in asking people whether they're coal heavers from Wigan or chimney sweepers from Stoke-on-Trent.
He was hugely famous in a medium which I suspect he fundamentally despised. I mean, he didn't really believe this was worthy of any kind of intellectual attention, and yet here he was, this big star in it. He was an unhappy man. His life hadn't turned out, I suspect, the way he would have wanted it.
Harding's private life was in turmoil, and the nature of this live interview in 1960 was groundbreaking. Everyone had assumed Harding was unfeeling and obnoxious, but now they found he was deeply unhappy with life.
Are you afraid ever of death?
I'm not afraid of death, I'm afraid of dying. I should be very glad to be dead, but I don't look forward to the actual process of dying.
I remember his telling me, he said, my doctor tells me that if I go on drinking as much as I am now, I shall drop dead of a heart attack. I've got to halve my quantity of whiskey. Do you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to double it. Why? Not bloody-mindedness, but because he didn't want to be alive. He didn't have anything to be proud of. If he could die of a heart attack, it would suit him very well.
You're not bothered at the thought of being dead if you could get over the hurdle of dying without alive.
I would much rather be dead than alive if I hadn't got to go through the miseries of actually dying.
The watching public were further shocked when Freeman, not knowing that Gilbert Harding's mother had recently died, pressed him hard on the matter of death.
Now, was your mother, who is still alive,
She's dead.
I beg your pardon.
We all knew immediately, oh my God, that's his mother. And of course he, on live television, could not answer. He murmured.
Have you ever been with a person dying?
Yes, only once.
Do you remember that? Someone very close to you? Did it make a vivid impression?
It did, yes, yes.
Is that the only time you've seen a person dead?
The only ones, yes.
Yes.
He came very close to breaking down, because this was the single most asphyxiating sorrow of his life.
Gilbert Harding's interview was a revelation and resulted in a change in the public perception of the gruff old man. Suddenly, people were sympathetic and he received hundreds of letters of support.
The public was very much on Gilbert's side. I mean, they did not understand the point of the questioning. They really didn't in those days. This poor man being brutally questioned by an unfeeling head. We only saw the back of John Freeman's head, and they were very much on his side.
Only 8 weeks later, Gilbert Harding collapsed and died on the steps of the BBC, the first victim of television celebrity. His harrowing interview on Face to Face and subsequent death proved to be a symbol of the importance that the British public now placed on television and its new showbiz set.
TV became the most important entertainment in everybody's life, something they could all share, something they could all discuss.
The next showbiz set will reveal how the 60s were to bring a complete reversal in the BBC's fortunes. New radical leaders would usher dear old auntie into a new age of rebellion and groundbreaking BBC television programmes.
June the 13th, Christine Keeler becomes Conservative Party chief whip.
Suddenly people started identifying with the BBC again. We were us.
I ain't knocked you in!
The BBC were dragging us up by the bootstraps.
The coming decade would see a cultural revolution and give birth to a new showbiz set rising and falling like never before.
Now, I went so quickly, my feet hardly touched the ground.
That kind of stuff hadn't been on TV before. It wasn't allowed to be on TV before. And that was the revolution.
Well, that was an eye-opener. Can't wait for the next showbiz set, next Tuesday at 9. And tomorrow night, the nation's catwalk wannabes sharpen their claws for a brand new series of Model Behaviour. The auditions begin with a special, also at 9. Comedy drama next tonight on 4, denied his conjugal rights. Samad experiences the romance of India down the high street in white teeth.